I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. See you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love.
Good morning, everyone. It is so good to see you all, and welcome to anybody who's signing in online to worship with us today. Just a few announcements. You may not have noticed, but it's cold in here. We ran out of oil, and that is kind of the issue we're having right now, so you're just going to have to huddle up together and be more like a family. In that sense, try to stay as warm as possible. And the good thing is I don't have a massively like 2 hour long sermon today, so we won't have to freeze there. Another announcement is, if you have not gotten your pictures taken for the directory after service in the library here, just on the other side of this wall, we are doing the pictures and having those taken. So please, if you haven't gotten your new pictures done for the directory, let's get that done today. This is kind of the last day we have on schedule to be able to get that done. So right after service, it shouldn't take too long for you to get that done. Also, next week is potluck after service, and we most likely, I promise, I will try my hardest to make sure we have heat. so that it's not going to be quite like it is today. But that's potluck. Bring whatever you would like, and all are welcome. Were there any other pressing announcements that I needed to make? Just a quick reminder to the elders, we are having a meeting after service for the elders. We're going to get together and talk about some things that we've been working on. Anything else? Nope. All right. Will you please stand as we open with a word of prayer, and will the praise team start making their way forward? Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this time to be together, to worship you as a part of your body, Lord. We just thank you for this opportunity. And though it may be cold, Lord, we are so glad to be here with fellow brothers and sisters. Father, we just pray that our worship today will be a pleasing aroma coming up to you. Father, we love you, we praise you, and it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I see the old timers know where the heat vent in the church is. And there's no heat.
Repeat after me, if you would. Psalms 145:3.
Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised, and his greatness is unsearchable.
Maybe that's faith, right?
Great is the Lord, he is holy and just, by his power we trust in his love. Great is the Lord, he is faithful and true, by his mercy he proves his love. Great is the Lord, and worthy of glory. Great is the
remain standing a little better in this cold, isn't it? Okay, John 1, 1 John 4, 19. We love him because he first loved us.
Precious is he, and
2 Timothy 3:16. Every scripture is inspired by God and useful for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness.
Okay, testing, testing, okay. Oops.
No, I was instructed to do this. Is it working? That's an inside joke. The first time my husband spoke, I was running the slides, and I kept getting distracted, and he would do this for me to move the slides up. So, anyway. Hi, everybody. I was going to ask you, and I still am, who among you likes to do the dishes after we eat? Anybody like to do dishes? Well, great. You guys can come home with me because I have a lot of fun planned for you. They're okay. I have thought about one thing that would be good about doing dishes right now, and that's because it would warm my hands up, right? I do the dishes. My hands are really cold. That works good. But I don't really like to do dishes. I haven't when I was your age, and I still haven't learned to like that. And I think it runs in my family. You know why? Because my mom said that her younger sister hated to do the dishes, and when people weren't watching, she would hide the dirty pots and pans in the oven and stuff. And so then when my mom would go in to do the next meal, she couldn't find the pots and pans. And when she did find them, what do you think they were like?
Dirty.
Dirty and hard and crusty and yucky, right? Yeah. Well, I have learned a Bible verse that helps me when I have to do stuff that I don't like to do. And maybe it'll help you too. It says in 1 Thessalonians 5:18, "In everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you." Who wants to be thankful for dishes, right? Yeah, oh, good. All right, they're hanging in there. You guys may come home with me today. Mm-hmm. Well, see, the thing is, now when I start to do dishes, I begin by thanking God that I had food to put on my plate to dirty those dishes. And then as I wash dishes, I just spend time with God. And it's really fun because he will talk to me and he will teach me lessons. Lessons about life just through doing the dishes. And one of the lessons is, dirty dishes and pots are sometimes like our hearts. We're supposed to keep them clean, but sometimes we make mistakes or somebody hurts us or we hurt somebody else and we hold it in our heart and in our mind. And God doesn't want us to do that because it's not good for us. And so he tells me, just like the dishes, and I put them in the sink and I soak them to make them easier to wash. If you take care of the dish right away, it doesn't get all crusty. Like Andy's always telling me, rinse your plate off, and I'll say, I haven't finished eating yet, right? But anyway, so God says that if you don't take care of those things that are in your heart, you can become what we call a crusty person. Who knows what a crusty person is? A crusty person is known as somebody that's hard to get along with. Because we got all this stuff that kind of irritates our hearts, so we're always kind of irritable. So, did you know that the Bible is called the water of the Word? Did you know that? Yeah? And so, what we do when we make a mistake, we go to God and we talk to him about it, and he'll say, you know, go to the Word and look up what's bothering you there, and it'll help you, it'll comfort you if you're hurting, or help you learn what to do to get over whatever's bugging you and get that out of your heart so that we don't turn into crusty people. So the thing is, the longer we wait to do that, the longer it takes to wash that out of our heart and longer it takes to wash it out of the plate. So the thing to remember is, in everything give thanks, for this is the will of God concerning you in Christ Jesus, right? If you come in with a good attitude, I love to spend time with God talking when I don't like what I'm doing. And it sort of turns things around for me. because I don't think about, I'm not enjoying this. I think about, wow, I'm having a good conversation with God and practicing the presence of God, and that's a really good way to live your life. Thanks for listening. That's right. And he went there because he loves us so much, right? That's right. Well, you are able to get up and go with CJ now. Thank you for listening so well.
Good job, Candy. Okay. 1 Corinthians 11:24 through 26. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Would you stand, please, and prepare for communion?
Morning. This morning I would like to talk about Jesus' love for us. There are so many scriptures that talk about his love for us, so I will read just a few of them. In John, let me see here. Yeah, John 5:10, "I will keep my commandments, I shall abide in my love, even as I have kept my Father's commandment, I abide in his love. Romans 13:10. Love worketh all ills to his neighbor, therefore love is fulfilling of the law. And in 2 Thessalonians 2:16, now our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God, even our Father, which have loved us, have given us everlasting consolation and good hope through grace. In 1 John 2:15, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. We should always love our Lord Jesus Christ and love our neighbors as ourselves, because he that hateth his brother is in darkness and knoweth not where he goeth, because the darkness hath blinded his eyes, but he hath loveth his brother abideth in the light, and Jesus is the light. In 1 John 3:18, it says, my little children, let us love in word, neither in tongue, but in deed and in truth. In 1 John 4:7, it says here, beloved, let us love one another, for the love of God is in everyone that loveth and is born of God and knoweth God. Okay. In 1 John 4:11, it says, beloved, if God so loved us, we ought to also love one another. And also in 1 John 4:18 says, there's no fear in love, but perfect love chaseth out fear, because fear hath torment. He that feareth is not made perfect in love. So if we love God, we should all love, not the ones that we choose, but all. In 1 Timothy 2:1, it says here, I exhort therefore that first of all, supplication, prayer, intercession, and giving of thanks be made for all men. So we need to pray always. And here in 1 John 5:1-2, it says, whosoever believeth that Jesus Christ is born of God, and everyone that loveth him that begot loveth him also that begotten of him. By this we know that we love the children of God when we love God and keep his commandments. So we know that Jesus Christ loves us very much. That's why he died for us on the cross. So when we come here to the table, we have to remember that when we take the bread and the juice, why he died for us on the cross. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, I pray that we all understand his love for us, and that we come here every Sunday to worship you, Lord, and give you praise. We ask this always in your blessed name, Lord Jesus. Amen.
I got my mic on now. Hopefully you guys brought coffee. You know, it's kind of funny that this is what's going on today with the heat and everything, because I think it will apply very well to remind us of what my title is right up there, Living in Awe of God. Isn't it nice to have heat? Isn't it nice that he provides those things? And when we don't have them, we often are reminded just how blessed we truly are. But I'd like to start off today by asking a question. How well do we as people keep the awe and wonder of God within our hearts? Just think about that for a minute. How well do we as people keep the awe and wonder of God within our hearts? You see, this is an interesting and important question to ponder and evaluate within our lives. So let's just examine it together for just a moment. I think Pastor Scott Kircher, in one of his sermons, helps to put this question into perspective well when he tells about the time when he used to work at the CME, which is a large company that deals with the stock market and trading and things like that. And people would always ask him if that was really exciting. And typically, he would just answer that it's just a job like any other. However, that was not always the case for Scott, and I think we can all relate with what he says next. Scott goes on to say that when I first started working down there, I remember walking in and onto the trading floor for the first time and thinking that this place is just awesome. The wonder and the excitement were just exhilarating for him. People yelling and screaming, papers flying everywhere, people communicating with hand signals across huge trading rooms. It was really exciting and awe-inspiring. Well, if that excitement of working didn't apply well to you, Scott continues on to go and paint this imagery of marriage. And he explains how before you were married, during the dating time, the excitement of talking to your love, interest on the phone or seeing that person, the getting ready to go on a date, putting on cologne or perfume and nice clothes, looking your best, then that great moment of getting married, the wedding night and the honeymoon and even the first couple of years, looking forward to getting home from work and spending the evening just together. Then sadly, if you aren't careful and extremely intentional, the reality is often we fall for the trap and get into the routine, and the excitement and the awe can oftentimes seem to fade away. So why did I share Pastor Scott's two short applications with you today? Well, because if we take what Pastor Scott is saying and continue down his thought process to the very end result, well, then we all have to ask an extremely important question. Have we allowed our excitement and awe of God to slip away and harden our hearts towards him? Just like we sadly do in other aspects of our life. You see, the cold hard truth is that oftentimes we go through this life in such a routine that we allow our awe and our wonder of God to slip out of our hearts. He becomes more of a second thought. As we'll see in our text today, Pharaoh had this problem. Moses and Aaron have this problem at times, and the Israelite people have this problem at times, and even jumping all the way to the forward to the New Testament, the Pharisees and the scribes, they also had this problem. Yeah, they were religious people. Yeah, they were serving God, but yet the awe and wonder of him had started to slip away for many. And we today, we're not much different. We as people have short memories. Do we not? And it's way too easy for us to just get in the habit of doing things the same old way, much like the two examples Scott gave for us, in which the truth is we become lazy and focus on the wrong aspects of life. Our American culture is really bad at this because it's a go, 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 go culture. We never sit and think and remember God. It's the way our culture works, but it's sad because that's what can happen. We become lazy, focused on the wrong aspects of life, completely unaware that a better way of doing things is already here for us through Jesus. And now this better way that I'm talking about is not just for the here and now, but it's forever. I mean, if you lose the awe and wonder of God now, how do you think heaven would be? The fact is, with a simple shift in heart attitude towards and through Christ, he can and will help you transform every activity in your life into moments of worship that glorifies the Lord with such an awe and an excitement for who he truly is as God, our Creator, our Lord, our Savior, our King, our Father. I really like what Candy brought up in what she was talking about with the dirty dishes. It applies massively to what I'm talking about here. 1 Corinthians 10:31 tells us that so whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God. Likewise, 1 Peter 4:11 says, if anyone speaks, they should do so as one who speaks the very words of God. If anyone serves, they should do so with the strength God provides, so that in all things God may be praised through Jesus Christ. To him be the glory and the power forever and ever. Amen. Simply put, we need to be a people who live with a heart of awe and wonder for who God is and what he has done. In fact, that is exactly the point of our text for today and what it's leading us to come to understand. So today we will be spending our time in Exodus chapter 7, starting in verse 8, and we will be going all the way through to chapter 10. But before you all get up and walk away, don't worry, I'm not planning on reading all of this text for the day. Believe me, I considered it, but by the time I was done reading it at home, it was like that was basically a sermon in and of itself, lengthwise. So we're not going to be doing that, though I do strongly encourage you to go through and read it all for yourself this week. Instead, I'm going to take some time to summarize everything that takes place within these four chapters. Then we will take a deeper dive in order to help us all understand just how important it is that we all never forget to live with a heart of awe and wonder for God, for who God is and what he has done for us. So the story for today starts in Exodus chapter 10. And going from about verse 8 through 13, we see how Aaron and Moses confront Pharaoh with God's power. This is that scene, you may be fond of it, with the serpent, where the staff's thrown down and it turns into a serpent, in which one of those brief incidents, as Aaron's staff is turned into the serpent, it embodies the main elements of the 10 plagues that are to follow. It's kind of interesting how before the 10 plagues that followed, there's this moment of confrontation with Pharaoh in which the serpent, the staff turns into the serpent, his magicians turn theirs into two other serpents, but then God's serpent eats theirs. See, God shows his power and Pharaoh tries resisting using the magicians, then the obvious conclusion happens in which Pharaoh is no match for God. God's snake ate his snakes. He should concede victory to the Lord at this point, but he doesn't, which will yield disastrous circumstances for him and his people. Basically, the first five verses summarize the battle between the Lord God and Pharaoh that is to follow, providing us as the audience with a snapshot of the drama to unfold and the final victory that will be won with God. It's really interesting on how that works. This one moment with the serpent foreshadows the victory God's going to have. Then in chapter 8, verses 1 through 15, God unleashes frogs upon Egypt. Chapter 7, 14 through 25, water into blood, which I had those mixed up. The water into blood comes first, then frogs upon Egypt. And in 8, 16 through 19, God uses Aaron to unleash gnats from the dust upon Egypt. Now, I group these three plagues together because as we continue on through the other six plagues, a pattern will reveal itself in which God will provide two plagues that he gives a forewarning to Pharaoh, as well as to the Israelites, of what is coming. And he commands Moses and Aaron to prepare and go to speak to Pharaoh with these two plagues. The third plague, though, in the group, then comes without any formula whatsoever. In a sense, God just tells Aaron to do it immediately. So as the other six plagues continue, this same pattern from God will continue as well. Two plagues with a heads up, and then one without. This is an important pattern to remember because it shows us how God is providing multiple different stages in which Pharaoh could relent. However, stubbornly, Pharaoh will not, and instead he will lie, he'll manipulate, and outright refuse to see God as the victor, even when many of Pharaoh's very own people begin to understand just how real, powerful, and mighty God truly is. I mean, there's even a point in there when the magicians themselves are like, "This is from God." And Pharaoh's, "I don't care." There's times where Pharaoh pretends, "Oh yeah, I'm relenting." But really he's not, because it goes also in these stages as Pharaoh goes, "Yeah, well, your people aren't going to go." The next time, then he goes, I'll let you go. How many are going to go? Well, the men are going to go. Oh, no. Are you saying the men, women, and children? Pharaoh says, "No, I'm not going to allow the women and children to go. They have to stay." And eventually towards the end, he says, "Fine, the men, the women, and the children can go to sacrifice to God, but the cattle has to stay." See, Pharaoh's still not relenting. He's still going, "I'm in control of the situation." You come to the last three plagues in the story, beginning in chapter 8, verse 20, and concluding all the way to chapter 9, verse 12. Well, these aren't the last ones, but we're leading up to them. Here we see how God unleashes flies, kills the Egyptians' livestock with the plagues, and brings boils upon the Egyptians. Yet again, Pharaoh is presented with opportunities to repent and submit to the Lord. However, yet again, he refuses to surrender. Finally, the last three plagues are provided before that tenth one. And that goes all the way from chapter 9 through 12 all the way to the end of chapter 10, in which hail, locusts, and ultimately darkness falls upon Pharaoh and all of his people, darkness over the whole entire land. It's at this point in which Pharaoh still refuses to let all the people of God go, ending the chapter 10 with this chilling threat to Moses. In verses 28 and 29 of chapter 10, Pharaoh says, "Get away from me. Beware. Do not see my face again, for in the day you see my face, you shall die." Moses said, "You are right. I shall never see your face again." Therefore, setting up the last and final plague to come, in which Pharaoh's own words are going to become all too true for him, just not in the way that he's expecting them to turn out. Now, I stopped, and we're not going to talk about that 10th plague. That's for the next time I preach. That needs its sermon all on its own, talking about the Passover and all those things and how that relates to Jesus. So we're just dealing with the first nine plagues. Therefore, we got to fiddle with this just a little bit, because it's a long section, and it just seems like a whole lot of wrath, which it is. But now that we've completely condensed all four chapters, it's time to turn our attention to what exactly we can learn from all this. Well, simply put, there are a whole lot of ways that I have heard others trying to apply this section of Exodus for today. Going all the way to focus on Pharaoh's continual heart, which is there, the fact that God kept all the Israelites safe during all these plagues. Or even the concept of how an obedient servant never wavers, just like Moses and Aaron never wavered as they faced Pharaoh during these plagues. Now, of course, all those elements are here in these four chapters, but they are not really what this section of Scripture is trying to get us to understand or apply for our lives. And to be frankly honest, it's not how Israel was to apply this moment either, as they lived in the middle of all these miraculous moments from the Lord. So the question remains, what is all this plague business about? And how can we apply it to our lives for today? Well, the simple answer is these four chapters are entirely about God revealing himself, his might, his power, his glory, his holiness, his complete and utter control of all creation, not only to Pharaoh and the Egyptians, not only for the Israelites to see, but he is also revealing all these things about himself to us as well. And the Lord is revealing all this to us so that one very important concept won't be missed. And the only key point I want to focus on for today is the fact that we all need to choose to live with a heart of awe and wonder for God, towards God for who he is and what he has done. See, Pharaoh and the Egyptians had to learn this lesson the hard way. Today, we cannot make the same mistake. God deserves to have all of creation's love and adoration, and we should adore him with awe and wonder in our hearts. But the sad reality, just like I alluded to in the introduction, is that we as people often get lazy. It's a fact. We let our pride take over like Pharaoh did, and we choose to forget the reality that God is real. His power is unimaginable. And he has revealed himself to us as his creation. You might remember way back, we did a series, Do You Actually Believe What You Claim to Believe? God is real. God has power. He is our creator. Therefore, since God has revealed himself, the only logical decision for any sane person to take is to turn to him and live with a heart of awe and wonder for who God is and what he has done. I mean, not only here in Exodus do we see God's amazing power on display. I mean, it was a massive display of power. But just fast forward to the New Testament and Jesus himself. Jesus, God in the flesh, fully man and fully God. Jesus, who came from the very glory of heaven to not only to save us from our sin and death, but to reveal the very love and grace of God towards all of sinful humanity. Jesus, our Lord and Savior, who alone has revealed the heart of God to us so that we can all not just simply understand that God exists, but we can come to understand that he deeply loves us. And he wants to have a very real and a very personal relationship with us, where he is our Father and we are his adopted sons and daughters. I mean, just look at what Hebrews chapter 1, verses 1 through 4 says about Jesus, starting in verse 1. God, after he spoke long ago to the fathers and the prophets in many portions and in many ways, in these last days has spoken to us in his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, through whom also he made the world. And he is the radiance of his glory and the exact representation of his nature and upholds all things by the word of his power when he had made perfection of sin or purification of sin. He sat down at the right hand of the majesty of God on high, having become as much better than the angels, he has inherited a more excellent name than they. Can you start to see how important Jesus is? The exact representation of God. Jesus, our Lord and Savior, Jesus, the exact representation of God and his nature in everything. We are revealed so much more about God than even Pharaoh got to see. And Jesus, who is the radiance and the glory of God, is calling us. We lowly sinners. He's calling us into a relationship with him. That should excite you. Who are we that the God of all creation would even care? And yet he wants a very personal relationship with you. I mean, how can we not be a people who live with a heart of awe and wonder for who God is and what he's done? How could we ever allow the excitement of what it means to be saved and to be adopted into God's family ever fade from our hearts? But the reality is often we do, don't we? God takes a back seat, a back burner. We often take for granted just how blessed we are because of Christ. And because of that, we, just like our jobs, just like so many of our relationships, become cold in heart. And we lose the excitement of what being a Christian really means. The one and only God of this universe loves you. Do you believe that fact? By the way, that was not a hypothetical question. I am truly asking and I want a response. So let me ask you again. Do you believe the fact that the one and only God of this universe loves you? Thank you. I know it's church, but it's okay for us to talk. Then we as his children must always live with a heart of awe and wonder for who God is and what he has done at all times. When things get hard, even when things are going well. This is a concept of putting God in his rightful place, not only within this universe, but within our hearts as well. God is God, and as God, he deserves our worship. He deserves our awe and wonder. I didn't put this in here, but I'm going to talk about it just slightly. Have you noticed or even heard? You might not have, because the mainstream media is doing a really good job of trying to keep this quiet. There's been a revival going on in Kentucky. A massive one. And I find it very interesting because I've seen people, when they're talking about it, they've actually connected the idea that, remember was it the Oscars or whenever the famous people go to glorify themselves? One of them, there was a really disgusting thing that took place in which someone had dressed up as Satan as they were singing, and it was like, everybody was like, oh, Satan had the opportunity to have everybody watch him for one night. Then God said, I'm going to put down my cup, and he started a revival in Kentucky. where it lasted well over 2 weeks. It's still ongoing. So much that this little town in Kentucky had to actually go, we have no more room for people who are coming in. Haven't we been praying for revival for this nation? The media has done a good job. They don't want you to know that this is what's going on. Of course they wouldn't, because Jesus is being glorified. These people have had their eyes open and they are worshiping God with awe and wonder, and it's unstoppable. Praise God. We cannot lose this awe and wonder of God, lest the fight be lost. Because if we lose that, who's going to share the truth? We can't lose it. I mean, just look at David and his life. He danced for the Lord. Don't ever let church say you can't go dancing. He sang for the Lord. Oh, we can sing. We don't just have to sing. You can even raise your hands and do it. And he played and created great music for God as he faithfully served him. And it was because David deeply knew God and loved him with all of his heart. And so he gave God all his reverence and awe in everything that he did. Now, of course, David, just like all of us, he had his failures. But he was a man after God's own heart. He loved God. Corey Free once explained it like this when he said, "The world in which we live is full of countless things that make us afraid. Some fear spiders, that's me. Others snakes, others heights, others highways, and some even fear tight spaces." He goes on to say, "As a boy in the third grade, I went on a field trip to a state park to explore caves. In a single file line, we entered a small cave, and I remember feeling very anxious about the tight quarters. I also had a fear of the dark, and the cave was very dark in some areas. However, when the teacher asked if any of us had a problem with entering the cave, I didn't want anyone to think I was scared or intimidated, especially not any of the girls that were in the line. My fear of other people's negative perception was stronger than my fear of the cave." Corey then connects his story like this as he says, "There are three types of fear: holy fear, a healthy fear, and a harmful fear." Well, what type of fear are we to have of God as his people? You see, we are to have a holy fear, which does not mean to be afraid of God, but to be in awe of the Lord. The fear of the Lord is an awesome reverence and altogether respect for the greatness, the goodness, and the glorious nature of God. I want to see more revivals going on, just like in Kentucky. I want to see God's people on fire and unashamed to worship him in awe and wonder. I mean, I don't want someone to even have to ask the question, is that a Christian? They should know, because they see how much we love God, how much we worship God in everything that we think, say, and do. In other words, live with a heart of awe and wonder for who God is and what he has done. Brothers and sisters, to simply summarize things for you today, Exodus chapter 8 through 10 can teach us a lot. But above all else, it teaches us all about the very power of God. The question is, will you let God's power move in your heart today? Will you let God's power move in your heart today? There are more revivals waiting to happen. But we can't be afraid to worship God. to give him our awe and our wonder. Let God's power move in your heart today. Will you choose to live with a heart of awe and wonder for who God is and what he has done for you through Jesus Christ? Will you pray with me? Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for the fact that you have revealed yourself to us. You have displayed your mighty power through your Son, Jesus Christ, who came down to this earth, who went to the cross for us, who died and rose again, freeing us from sin and death, bringing us into relationship with you, God. That is something that we should never forget, never let slip away, Father. Please help us not to have hard hearts, but to have hearts that are focused fully on you, serving you, loving you, and letting this world know just how much you love them. Father, I pray that your power will work in our hearts today. I continue to pray for even more revivals, hearts turning to you, worshiping you, praising you, honoring you, and glorifying you, Father. Help us to be a part of starting those things. We love you, and it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So at this time, if the praise team will start making their way forward, I'd like to offer up a couple invitations today. If you happen to be here and Jesus is not Lord of your life, and you would like just how great he is, what he can do for your life, anytime during this song, you're welcome to come forward. We would love to, as the church, usher you into that relationship, usher you into the adoption into God's family. Also, I challenge you, and you don't have to come forward for this one, but to make a decision. If you've forgotten who God is, if you've forgotten how good he is, and have been putting him on the back burner, it's time to put him back where he deserves to be. That's a decision you can make in your heart right here and now. You don't have to come forward to do that. And finally, just in case you didn't know, another decision that you could make if you want to become a member here at church, please come forward during this song. It is a very simple process. You come forward, and I shake your hand and say, "Welcome to the family." So if you're not a member and you would like to place that membership, you can also come forward and do that as well. So will you please stand as we sing this song? Be seated. We have some trivia. At what time of the day did Moses have Aaron use his rod to strike the river?
Morning.
The morning? Which of the plagues below?
Which of the plagues
Yeah, bad odor in the land of Egypt.
Blood, I think.
Frogs.
Oh, frogs.
Because they all died. after God took them away, they all died, and they had to heap them up into piles. What did God command Moses to use to cause and spread the plague of boils? Ashes. What did God use to bring the locusts into Egypt? I know this one. It's a west wind, I think.
East wind.
Or east wind. East wind. Praises and prayers. And I am going to be sorry because I am not the greatest at reading other people's handwriting. Normally, my wife straightens all this out so I can read it because I'm just horrible. So if I mess up what I'm talking about, just correct me. But for Wanda, she's asking prayers for her nephew, Marshall. Is that correct? Marshall, who has stage 4 cancer. And then also for Wanda's nephew, who died in January of, and I'm... pancreatic and liver cancer. So prayers for the family. Levi's asking, please pray for his neighbor Judy. And also Levi is asking prayers, please pray for Claudia. She's having knee surgery tomorrow, so prayers for Claudia. And then Mike has asked prayers for Pastor Oleg Magnet. Did I get that right? He's the pastor who's spreading the word of God over in Ukraine right now. So be praying for him, especially as he's doing good work. And then continued prayers for Mike's leg and for prayers for MJ as well. And then... Bonnie Hall has a praise. Hudson is doing well and is 6 pounds now, which is an amazing. He was, if you remember, 3 months early. So he's 6 pounds now. He is still in the hospital. So prayers for his dad who has to go back to work. And I know that's going to be hard. Yeah, and continue prayers for Hudson. But yeah, it's not easy as a parent when you're dealing with that you want to go and work. You want to be there. And so... prayer for all of these things. Is there any that I may have missed?
Yes, my great nephew, he has an infection on his spine that they found yesterday, and they are doing a biopsy to see what it is susceptible to, what medicine. But he's in Dornbecker, so Wyatt is his name.
Wyatt, your great nephew. Mm-hmm. Okay, so he's having issues and he's getting tests and things like that all figured out. And so prayers for Wyatt. Yep, continued prayers for our nation. We need it. And I think God's he's doing something interesting. It's going to be a fun ride to see what he's doing and be a part of it. I just asked prayers. Ashton and the girls, they weren't feeling very good, so they stayed home today. Hopefully they get to feeling better, and I don't get it because my birthday's coming up soon, and I'm supposed to go do things. I don't want to be sick. Steak doesn't quite taste as good when you're sick. So, I know, selfish reasons. I repent. All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer. And all these were named, and I'm just going to do a broad and general prayer for everybody regarding the various different things that were brought up. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you, and I just praise you. Lord, thank you for the opportunity that we get to come before you in prayer. And we know that you hear us, and we know that you want to work on our behalf, Father. We just come before you, Lord. You heard every name that was brought up with regards to surgeries and medical things that are going on, Father. And I just pray that you'd be with each and every one of them who are dealing with that, that the doctors would be tools in your hands, Father, that you would be able to help them. Heal them. Father, I also pray for those who have lost loved ones, who are struggling with grief, who may be going to lose loved ones soon, that you would be their comforter, Father. Bring them peace. Father, we just praise you for the fact that we do get, though we get all these prayer requests asking for you to move on our behalf, we get to see that you answer those prayers. We praise you for that, Father, for showing us that you love us. You truly do. Lord, I do just ask and lift up this nation. In fact, not just this nation, all the nations of this world, Father. This is oftentimes scary times with wars and rumors of wars and things like that. But Father, just like you have showed us in a little town here in the United States that revival's just around the corner. Father, we pray for a worldwide revival, that people would turn their hearts and souls to you, to live in awe and wonder of who you are and what you have done. Father, we thank you so much. It's in your holy name we pray. Amen. Will you please stand as we sing this final song?
Thank you for your faithfulness in coming today, and don't let this cold get you down, because we've been warm from the inside today. So let it flow out. Thank you.